Hey, Tested fans, Adam Savage here in my cave with a quickie show and tell, and it is a fan gift that came into our post office box last week. Regular viewers know that I have been sowing my oats on the big machines, on the mill and the lathe. I have spent a lot of the lockdown improving my machining skills and deepening my understanding of the levels of precision that these machines can achieve. And that's been a really lovely journey. It's also been a rough journey. See my video of making the giant nut and bolt out of brass. It is a fits and starts. Let's just say it is not a smooth narrative. Nothing is. One of my latest machining projects is this, which started out as a giant hunk of 1.5-inch thick aluminum. This is a piece of a build that is actually going to be fairly extensive. And again, this started out as a solid billet of aluminum, and I have now made it attached to, I mean, there's all these things that attach to this. You'll see this. But as I have been talking more and more about the machining and about the precision, some fans have been reaching out and sharing some of their knowledge with me. And Leigh Johnson from England has sent me a gift, and it is a pair of parallels. Now, what are parallels? Well, in the machinist's world, in the machinist's world, much of the machinist's job happens here between the jaws. Oh, here we go. Sorry. Much of a machinist's job, how do I say this? Much of the work that a machinist does, this is what happens when I don't think through the camera piece in my head before I say it. This is my milling machine. This is the vise. Not everything gets clamped into the vise, but most things, like a huge amount of a machinist's job takes place here between the jaws of the vise. And when you clamp stuff into the vise, you want to make sure that it's perfectly flat to the milling bit. And so you use things called parallels. And here is my set of parallels. They are all slightly different heights, starting from very small to very large. And they allow me to precisely place things super flat in the jaws of this vise. I can grab a lot or a little. Parallels are a completely vital tool for milling using a vise. And every machinist has a set or two. I am no different, but these parallels, these are of a totally different order. Leigh Johnson has actually a story to tell me, and I'm going to read some of it to you because it's lovely. In 1985, he started an apprenticeship as a turner, a machinist, with an aircraft manufacturer, British Aerospace. As part of his training, he made a number of tools and aids. This is something that I've seen a lot of, that he would use once he left training school. And he says, as you well know, a tool is something that has to be used, and these particular items, sadly, are not and will never be used by him again. Please find enclosed a pair of parallels as made by all of the British Aerospace apprentices from 1963 to 2006 when they closed the training school. Oh, this particular pair were made by me. I started their manufacture in the September of 1985. The very year I moved into New York City to attend NYU, or to pretend to attend NYU. Completed them near the summer of 1986. I had just moved into the East Village. As I moved to the training school and was introduced to and became proficient on more types of machines. Take a look at this. So Leigh graciously walks me through the steps of these parallels manufacture. Now, when you buy machine equipment, it is often rated to whether it's accurate to 1/1000th of an inch, to 0.5, 1/10000th, or even greater. And in general, when you buy the entry grade parallels, I think mine are entry grade, they're accurate to like about 1/1000th of an inch, plus or minus 1/1000th across their width. And frankly, they're more accurate than that. That's just their rating. These are made to a much higher standard. And here is the process. The bright, drawn, mild steel raw material was milled flat and square on four faces using a vertical milling machine. That's what it's behind me there. The ends were then machined to length on the same machine. Now, that machine is totally capable of accuracy to within a thousandth, but when you want to get past that, you're going to have to move on to another machine. The center wasted section was removed from each side using a shaping machine. I'm not even sure what a shaping machine is. I'm going to have to look that up. The apertures were then drilled, bored, and chamfered on a jig bore machine. Okay, so not a drill press, not a mill, and these are all different sized holes. A jig bore machine. I stamped my name on one end of each. There they are, L. Johnson. They were sent for case hardening and chemical bluing. That's the only part that Lee did not play any part in. Both items were then match ground on a surface grinder. Now, the milling machine comes in and it cuts away material using the edge of a blade and slices away. And it can pull off you can pull off a lot of material in a single pass, 30, 40,000, depending on the material and the type of bit. But when you want to get to that sub-thousandth accuracy, you've got to use a surface grinder. And that can bring these, he brought these to a runout tolerance of 0.00002 inches. That is 2/10,000ths of an inch, or 1/5 of 1/1,000th of an inch. What is a good way to tell you about 2/10? A sheet of paper is about 4/1,000ths. So you could, it's surpassingly accurate. As for what I did with them, Lee Johnson used these and others like them while he manufactured parts for the Harrier, AV-8B, Hawk, and T-45 aircraft. Wow. In 1990, he hung up his tools, and these have sat in a dark corner ever since. Please accept this gift for your shop. They deserve a better life than being sat in a cupboard for another 30 years. Lee, thank you. In the close-ups, I know it looks like these have some blemishes on them, but as I can lay my fingers on them and feel them, I can tell you that they were well-loved and well-used, and I am honored to have these have a pride of place in my shop, and I will use them and think of you each time. I really appreciate you sending these. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. Let's see here. Oh, he has one more story. To give you a little bit of history, I used them to produce the test machinings for the proof of concept for the T-45 slatted wing. The T-45 aircraft is a carrier-based variant of the Hawk fast jet trainer. The factory in my home village manufactures all the Hawk and T-45 aircraft. We sold a batch of T-45 to the U.S. Department of Defense for use in their new carriers, but there was a slight problem. The cruising speed for the carrier was not quite what we had been told it was. That meant that when the pilot flew slow enough to land on the carrier, he was very close to the stalling speed and he fell out of the sky rather than landing safely. If he came any hotter, then he ran the risk of overshooting the deck and dropping into the water, whereupon the runway runs you over. Neither outcome is especially pleasing. The guys in our design department came up with a modification to the leading edge of the wing that slid outwards and down when coming in to land. This changes the geometry of the wing and allows for a much slower flight speed than before stalling. I was chosen as the machinist to work on the initial prototypes of the machine components. Therefore, geometry was finalized and released before the geometry was finalized and released for full production. Before the geometry was finalized and released for full production manufacture. I have a very clear memory of using these parallels, along with a lot of plasticine, in an attempt to add mass when milling a deep, thin-walled feature. I used these parallels because the holes allowed them to be held in place by the plasticine. My test machinings were moved into full production after a successful test flight by the chief test pilot, and all subsequent wings for the T-45 were of this new variant. He says, you now own a little piece of aviation. You now own a little piece of aviation history. Oh, he also wears Phonak hearing aids. I have had phone accidents in the past, and he's obsessed with Omega watches. He possesses one, the exact make and model of this one, and he's a Star Wars nut. Lee, once again, I can't thank you enough for the parallels, for the stories, and for the camaraderie. Thanks very much, man. Thanks for joining me for this show and tell. I'll see you guys next time.